Welcome to CFR's Higher Education webinar. I'm Irina Faskanis, Vice President of the National Program and Outreach here at CFR. Today's discussion is on the record, and the video and transcript will be available on our website, cfr.org/academic. As always, CFR takes no institutional positions on matters of policy. We're delighted to have Tony Allen with us today to talk about the role of historically Black colleges and universities in the United States. Dr. Allen is president of Delaware State University. Previously, he served as the university's executive vice president and provost. In 2021, Dr. Allen was appointed by President Biden to chair the president's board of advisors on historically Black colleges and universities, and he also served as CEO of Biden's Presidential Inauguration Committee. Prior to his time at Delaware State University, he worked at the Bank of America for 13 years, where he developed and led the Corporate Reputation Group. And he is the founding president of the Metropolitan Wilmington Urban League, co-founder of Public Allies Delaware, and chair emeritus of the National Urban Fellows. So Tony, thank you very much for being with us today. I want to just turn it over to you to talk about the role of historically Black colleges and universities in higher education in the United States, historically and today.
And thank you for having me. It's a real pleasure to be with all of you, certainly with the Council of Foreign Relations. I just want to start personally. I'm a first-generation college student, and my mother was a teenage mom, and my father never finished the 11th grade. So being able to be in this role means a lot to me from a proximity standpoint, and really being able to guide one of the nation's leading HBCUs is really the professional dream of my life. So I take this very personally, in addition to trying to run a great institution. With respect to historically Black college universities across the country, we are almost at 175 years in existence. I don't think I need to tell anybody on the phone that we were started for some very specific reasons as it related to higher education access for African-American students. But we have really become a powerhouse, a force, not only in the African-American community, but in the broader citizenry at large. There are only 3% of historically Black, there are 3,000 college universities in the country. Only 3% are historically Black colleges, only 3%. But even today, we still produce 20% of all Black graduates. So just think about that for a moment, the power of our return on investment across many, many disciplines. May have heard these numbers, but 80% of Black judges and lawyers started at an HBCU. More than 50% of all Black doctors started at an HBCU. 40% of Black congressmen today started at an HBCU. And the number one driver for lower income African-American people to get into the American middle class today is still their attendance at a historically Black college university. So the real power and frame of our institutions are significant, but our voices over the years have been quieter. We don't have the same kinds of profile. A lot of it has to do with the fact that many of us are still low resource institutions, even though we're providing great value to the students that come here. Since the murder of George Floyd and Breonna Taylor and so many others during that summer of 2020, we've actually seen our profile grow significantly. We've tried to take advantage of that to tell the HBCU story in a much richer way than we have been able to do in the past. And we think that's had some significant merit. I can tell you, when I think about COVID-19, I always say that one pandemic, COVID-19 itself, exposed another. Which is continuing race relations in America. And when, you know, I thought about it this time around, you know, we've had these kinds of experiences as it relates to public safety interaction with police for a long, long time here. But this felt like the first time that so many folks were watching the same thing. So regardless of where you come from, what you look like, you could not turn your eyes away from some of the tragic incidents we saw in that summer. And I think that has people thinking in a much more deliberate and different way. coupled that with what we've seen with respect to the elections that ensued, the political unrest that came after that, we find ourselves in a place where historically Black colleges and universities are becoming a real sign, true sign of opportunity for folks, again, regardless of what you look like or where you come from, that are otherwise underserved or locked out of the education system. There are 101 of them. Some of you will know the what I'd say are the usual suspects, the Howard Universities of the world, the Morehouse, the Spelman, North Carolina A&T, FAMU, but there are 101 across the country. We spend our time not only providing the type of quality education that our students deserve, but also being engines of social justice and change and research for that matter. So our ability to look through a lens with respect to research, regardless of discipline, is unique in the space because we're able to come from a place where we are trying to understand the forces and phenomena of the world and often how those forces and phenomena disproportionately affect people who don't have as much as others. We take great pride in that as well. I also like to talk a little bit about the communities we find ourselves in. You usually find an HBCU adjacent to or very much in a low resource community. What that means for that community is that they are an economic engine for that community. The 101 HBCUs at last look contributed more than $14 billion collectively to the gross domestic product in the country. So we're not just educational institutions, we're real forces of economic opportunity and growth as well. I like to say, I think we're the best return on value in the higher education landscape because of who we prepare. Now, so many of our students are first generation college students like me. More than three quarters of them are Pell Grant eligible, which I think you know is a low income standard. And we are changing the trajectory of their lives and their families' lives. So being able to spend time thinking through what that means, not only as it relates to opening economic doors of opportunity for them, but also giving them this notion that it's not simply enough to graduate, get a great job. You also have to give back as you've been given too, which is a theme I'd say across the HBCU landscape. I think it's why you find so many African-American leaders in this country across disciplines, as I mentioned, having gotten their start at an HBCU, because there is this ethic of service that really threads the needle across the HBCU landscape. Having said that, you heard my role as chair of the Board of Advisors for the president on HBCUs. That board has been around since 1976, really started under President Carter. And there has been an executive order issued each year to make sure that the White House initiative on HBCUs gets its attention and the board helps serve a role of guidance and oversight. Let me give you a sense of the four priorities we are just beginning to outline in that role. As you know, we just named a full council about 2 weeks ago. And we are thinking about four things that we really want to focus on. First is infrastructure. At HBCUs, there's a systemic disparity between HBCUs and other similarly situated universities who are predominantly white. That has a lot to do with the fact that we weren't always able to, and in some cases still don't get equitable funding for our living and learning spaces. So while we're able to provide the quality education, we want the environment to look like the quality education that our students are receiving. That's particularly important for any number of reasons, most notably our ability to attract and retain our students over the long term, as well as some faculty and staff. When you think about the learning spaces as it relates to the laboratory and research, being able to have first-class operations there really sends a message about how serious we are about creating the right environment. Second is the opportunity for us to access more partnerships and, quite frankly, dollars from the federal government by really being able to engage in a thoughtful way with those institutions. Many of those institutions, as you know, provide research grants and other support to many institutions, higher education institutions throughout the country. We want to make sure that we're getting our fair share of that as well. Some of you probably know that there are three research classifications put out by Carnegie Research 1, Research 2, and Research 3. Research 1 is the highest, and there are no HBCUs that have cracked that threshold of Research 1. That's important as well. As I said, lots of the research we do crosses any number of disciplines, but when you're thinking about building capacity for the longer term, you do want to have a few, I would say, comprehensive Research 1 HBCUs. That's a big priority. I know for the president, it certainly has been and will be for the council. And it's a growing movement that folks are just beginning to talk about in a real thoughtful and focused way. The third, excuse me, is more support for low resource students. We've had some progress actually on that score. There have been some increases in Pell and in the president's budget. In fact, there's a $2,100 increase. That has a lot of significance for continuing to retain our students. I can tell you on any number of occasions, the number one factor, particularly for low resource students, is their ability to continue to pay. And some of that is significantly reduced from a burden perspective by scholarships and the like, but oftentimes even those small dollars that things we might think of as small dollars are really significant dollars, not only to their students, but to their families. So having more opportunities for tuition support in particular is critical. And then the last one is focusing on the smaller HBCUs in our space. So like I said, you have historically heard of more notable HBCUs, as I said, Howard University, Morehouse, Spelman, et cetera. But there are a subset of smaller HBCUs that are delivering first-class quality education and need our attention and support. I say that to my HBCU colleagues as much as I do to anybody else. When one of us is uplifted, we all need to figure out a way to uplift everyone else. And that's important now more than ever because there's been such an attention on the HBCU community. So I probably talked too much, but just as an opening salvo, just wanted to give you a sense of the scale, the importance, and the ongoing impact of the HBCU community.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Tony. That was really terrific. We're going to go now to all of you for questions and comments. You can either raise your hand by clicking on the raised hand icon, or you can type your question in the Q&A box. And if you do that, please include your affiliation. And when you do raise your hand, I'll call on you and recognize you, and please state your institution too. So I'm going to go first to Majibulu Alufunke Okome.
Thank you very much. HBCUs are very important. I'm from Brooklyn College. I teach political science. But, you know, and I think they punch way above their weight. But there's a persistent underfunding of HBCUs. So what will it take for these institutions to be funded well enough so that they can do the good job that they're doing with less stress and more excellence?
Great question. Two responses. First, under the Biden administration, since he took office, HBCUs have received about $5.8 billion in additional incremental support. A lot has to do with COVID for sure. And we, like most colleges and universities, were significantly impacted from a revenue standpoint with respect to COVID. But that historic funding is an important first step. I always say it's a first step. It's not the only step, because I think to your question relative to sustainability of our institutions, it is critical that we have deeper, more significant and sustained partnerships, I'd say particularly with the federal government. As I said, there are lots of opportunities for us to do good work there. We've made some good progress at Del State with the USDA, who has increased their funding significantly this year and in years prior. We just completed a memorandum of understanding with USAID last fall. We expect that to have some meritorious results too. We all have relationships with the likes of NIH and NSF, but certainly not enough. So really having a sustained effort that folks can goal against. So if you are in a specific department relative to your engagement with HBCUs, we are making that a priority. The president's already done that himself just our responsibility to make sure that folks are following through. So that's first order of business. Second, there are some unique partnerships that have emerged again in the wake of summer 2020. So there have been a significant onslaught of support for HBCUs. But what I have tried to do, at least from a Delaware State perspective, is create unique opportunities for that funding to not be one time. Case in point, we've gotten $2 million from two major banks in the country. And instead of simply being able to use that for ongoing scholarship support or other needs that we have at the university, we've built a career pathways program that is really allowing us to access a number of employers who want to engage with HBCUs, but just don't know how. And that is creating a new pipeline. Not only is it going to help us with respect to placing our students, we actually think it's significant benefit to the companies themselves. And in both the cases, and one was Bank of America and one was JP Morgan Chase, their funding has actually been catalytic in encouraging more corporate partners to take a look at HBCUs. And we think that is really, really important.
Great. The next written question from Robert Ford, who's retired from Southern University, Dillard, FESU, and Texas Southern University. And he went to Southern University, Baton Rouge. He didn't hear anything about international development, especially Africa. Does your university have an international footprint? And does the HBCU White House initiative have an international program initiative? What progress can be cited?
You know, Aaron, before I answer that question, I just want to shout out every HBCU who you mentioned, because they're all terrific. Southern, Dillard, I think you said Fort Valley State, and Texas Southern University. Incredible, yes. Incredible HBCUs in their own right. With respect to my institution here at Delaware State, we actually have a Center for Global Africa. We started that center 4 years ago now, run by a professor named Ezra Arone. And the idea is for us to push much of our curriculum and study to not only the African continent, but the African diaspora. So we see there are lots of opportunities for that to emerge. We've created some significant partnerships with the African Union and the like on that score. And I can tell you there are, I'm just mentioning the institutions that are more that I'm more close to, but there are a number of HBCUs that are doing similarly situated things on the continent and in the diaspora, most notably is Morgan State University, led by President David Wilson. And I think as we continue to gain profile and momentum, I think you'll see us internationally across the world in a much more clear and concerted effort. At Dell State, we actually have been on mainland China for 7 years, having exported three programs there, one in accounting, one in physics, and one in sports management. And the interesting thing about that, in each of those programs, three different universities, 98% of those students are first generation college students. So we've stayed true to our mission as we've gone international. We have some similar programs in Jamaica and Costa Rica as well. So we're building capacity to make sure that we can take the HBCU experience across the continent.
Thank you. I'm gonna go next to Susan King, who has raised her hand.
Let me just ask you, I'm at UNC, so I have a great interest in Howard and the new center at Howard that Nicole Hannah-Jones is doing, partly because she's not coming with us. How will that benefit all the HBCUs, do you think?
That's so funny. Her team has reached out to me, I think it was just last week, to talk about the Center for Journalism and how she wants to extend opportunities for aspiring Black journalists in particular at HBCUs, but also wants to help tell the HBCU story in a much more comprehensive way. So I can't wait to spend time with her and hopefully leverage her tremendous talent in doing that. I have said on many occasions, HBCUs have a great story, but we do not have enough storytellers. So being able to demystify what it has been that has really built a leadership talent pipeline and an economic opportunity outline pipeline for so many low resource folks who are now leaders in our country is a story that deserves its time in the sun. And we as presidents, my colleagues and I, have to be much more deliberate about that in our ongoing work. I'm hoping that the Board of Advisors and things like Professor Jones Center gives us the kind of elevation we need so we can have other partners like the Council on Foreign Relations help us sustain that moment where we find ourselves.
Wonderful. And I'm going to take the prerogative of the moderator. I mean, we here at CFR are very much committed to diversity and looking at the pipeline for, into the foreign policy track. So what are the things that you're doing, that HBCUs are doing, and what could we be doing at CFR to help the next generation of leaders, graduates from HBCUs, get into diplomacy and State Department and just into this field?
So thank you for making that point. Here's what I would say, and this is not to you, but just to the broader community. First job is to show up. I have been, particularly in the corporate side, I find myself in a lot of corporate circles where CEOs are always saying, hey, we wish we could find more Black talent. We just can't find them. And normally what I say is you're not looking hard enough. As I said, we're producing over 300,000 Black graduates every year. And that's just HBCUs. I haven't talked about historically Black Greek letter fraternities and sororities. I have not talked about special associations that find themselves in their respective disciplines. We are out here. And in the case of the council in particular, and my students don't often think first about international development or diplomacy. And the way they get to have that sense is to be in conversation, regular conversations with organizations like yours. A great example is we were able to bring the director of USAID, as I said, to sign the MOU last fall. And she talked about, first of all, the largesse of that institution, the number of critical opportunities that she would have across the organization. And you can see our students just lit up because they didn't know. Those weren't their first thoughts. The other thing I'd say is the more we've been doing this more and more, particularly Del State, but I say HBCUs around the country, are creating more international opportunities. Remember that because we have so many first generation college students, oftentimes that means those students are first generation in many things. So they might not have gotten on a plane, might not have had the same dinner conversations that were more well-suited families had when they were sitting down for dinner and that sort of thing. So it behooves us to make sure that we come to them and we come to them early. The pipeline program I talked about with you effectively says, if you want to be with Delaware State over the long term, don't show up in a student's rising junior or rising senior year looking for the best in class in our institution. Show up from the moment they come to the institution. So we're creating a new kind of mentor networking opportunity so those students can learn what's available to them. The institutions themselves can get a sense of the quality of our students and they can have the kind of conversations they might not have their first day on an internship or their first day on a job, having not been in that environment or not been connected to that environment previously.
Thank you. And there's a nice note from Lorette Foster at Prairie View A&M University. So she's at the HBCU Faculty Network. Thank you for your institution coming on board with the HBCU Faculty Development Network. And she says, we're one of their great supporters. And that's because of Lorette. So we usually go out to their annual conference in October in the fall to present on CFR resources. And, you know, we are looking for more opportunities like that with different networks to sort of connect and talk and sort of make connections so that we can start feeding that pipeline. I'm going to go next to Jill Humphreys, who's raised her hand.
Hello.
Unmute yourself. Thank you.
Thank you. First of all, I want to say both of my primary questions were asked about the institutional pipeline for diplomacy, and then also the way in which HBCUs are potentially going to be involved in international development. But so I'll ask this question. I've been a educational exchange professor several times in several African countries. And when I've interfaced with the embassies there and they talk about opportunities for, in this particular context, African students coming to study in the US and they give their presentations, they've always left off HBCUs And I've had to, in fact, remind them, even though I'm teaching at University of Toledo in the African Studies department. So I'm actually interested in the way in which you, at an institutional level, address this issue of whether it's just benign oversight of when the public affairs officers at our embassies, wherever they are in the world, talk about exchange, educational exchange opportunities. There are so many under the ECA, Department of State's ECA Bureau, but they include HBCUs. And then the other part of that is, how do you see the particular way in which HBCUs, or more specifically, Black thought, Black political thought, may in fact influence our foreign affairs and diplomacy approach, particularly in Africa? Is there a unique particular perspective that we bring as African-American or Black diaspora in these arenas?
Well, the short answer is yes, no, to your last question. And I don't limit that to products of HBCUs necessarily, but I do think Black political thought, generally speaking, across the globe is important contextually for a couple of reasons. One, the way in which Black Americans in particular have had to navigate a landscape here now for hundreds of years, is an important lesson in perseverance, context, the framework of what I'd say classism, certainly sometimes racism, systemic in its effort, as well as sexism, which I think shows up particularly for Black women regularly as well. The second part about that is, as these things are happening across the world, I think our position relative to being able to influence is critical. This is an American point I'm going to make, but just remember, and this is no commercial for the president, but at the time that President Biden was running and the campaign was suffering mightily, there was a Black man in South Carolina, proud HBCU grad, Congressman Jim Clyburn, who said, "I know Joe Biden, and Joe Biden knows us," and he changed the state of his election. Talks significantly about our power block when we operationalize that. We don't always do that in the American context, but when we do, it's clear and compelling. I won't go over the events that happened as a result of that. The other point, I think your first question was just about how folks engage with HBCUs more clearly in the international space. It does really come down to two things. One, HBCU leaders like myself have to be much more concerted and thoughtful about where we see the opportunities. When you're in a low resource institution, any number of things come up that can take you away from building capacity for your institution. So you have to be deliberate about it. It's one of the reasons I think the advisory board has had many iterations, but this in particular, because of the moment, I think it will put us in some positions that we have not seen before. You may know that, I believe it's in every federal department now, but the president is making it a point to have racial equity as a priority and a person that's in charge of that. So I think you're going to see more opportunities there. I have not talked to as many federal government officials ever in my career as I have during this administration, because there's a clear priority on it. But that is our job, to make sure that we're telling that story, as I've said before. And then I think the unique programs, particularly as it relates to international exchange, we talk a lot about students. I would make sure that we spend equal time trying to export our intellectual capital and our faculty too. They need the opportunities themselves, many times have the expertise, and more often than not, in my case, have unique partnerships in country, because they're from a set country. So being able to give them that support, I think will have significant long-term results, but we have to be concerted in how we position all of that.
Thank you. I'm gonna take the next written question from Ambassador June Carter Perry, formerly of the State Department, retired and former diplomat in residence at Howard University, and currently a board member at American Diplomacy Publishers in Chapel Hill. What is your relationship with National University's African-American programs, such as the one at Princeton, directed by Dr. Eddie Glatter?
I don't have a direct contact with Dr. Glaude. I'm aware of his work, but I don't have direct contact there. I can tell you, and this could be a conversation for us. We have not been as concerted in developing those partnerships with national universities that have African-American programs. Some of it has just to do with making sure that we're elevating our voice in the conversation. And a lot of it just, you know, historic stuff, I'd say. And I know that's not an academic word, but I'd say historic stuff between larger PWIs and HBCUs, particularly those who are in near proximity one to another, sometimes limits our ability to be more thoughtful about those kinds of partnerships and collaboration. That's no excuse. I just think that's the reality. What we do, how we do partner, particularly in the STEM disciplines, I think is becoming more and more significant. This, for the first time, we got $10 million grant several years ago in partnership with the PWI up the street from us, University of Delaware. And it was the first time we were the lead partner in the grant. And that sends a lot of messages to my faculty and the importance of what they can do and how they can lead really big grants. I think you're getting to see some of those partnerships emerge too across the landscape. So doing more on that score in disciplines that are not specific to African-American programs, I think is important. And certainly really engaging thoughtfully with those institutions who are serious about the African-American studies discipline. It's certainly important to us, but not near what we should be doing in space.
Thanks, Tony. You references have been in your remarks, but can you talk about how the pandemic affected HBCUs and how you're coming out of it?
Yeah, I was reluctant to tell this story because I feel like I've told it 100 times, but like other universities, we sent our kids home in the March timeframe, all but about 200. Think of those 200 as otherwise homeless without Delaware State University, literally. We knew that was, one, a proxy for some of the students we actually had sent home who were from very vulnerable situations, but we knew we had to keep at least those 200. That was significant for a couple of reasons. Now, this is before any funding came our way. CARES Act, American Rescue Plan, we just used our own coffers to make sure that they were fed, that they were not getting anything with respect to academic continuity, that was progressing nicely. In some cases, we were sending money to them for them to send home. What it was an opportunity for us to say, and we knew it deep down, but it was clear that our students are coming to these institutions, not just for the quote unquote college experience. They're trying to change the largely economic trajectory for themselves, their families, and their communities. And it's not easy. So our ability to get our students back on campus was first order of business, and to do that quickly. We were able to develop a program with a place called Testing for America, which helped us develop our protocol, paid for all our tests for about 2 years, and allow us to bring our students back right the fall of 2020 and keep them safe throughout that time. So we're testing faculty, staff, and students three times a week at that time. We're doing aggressively, had really strong protocols, and had a less than 1% positivity rate on our campus, which we took great pride in then and take great pride in now. What I'd say for the broader HBCU community, we were fortunate. Some of my other colleagues weren't as fortunate relative to being able to bring their students back quickly. A lot of has to do with the fact that we don't have major endowments. The resources, like I said before, are often low as compared to our predominantly white peers. So it is significant. And the problem is that if you're not able to keep the academic continuity for many of my students, they will not come back. And we just couldn't accept that. What I can say, though, is many in the HBCU community did pretty well based on these notions that they knew who their students were, that they knew they were going to have to deliver something extra that was not foreign to them, sort of classic wraparound services that we already are known for. But to up that game wherever they found themselves, I think, was important for our own student survival. And what I think you've seen this generally in HBCU community, certainly in Del State, our retention rates increased. Our graduation rates were up, and equally important, because of the summer of 2020, in many places at HBCUs, enrollment has gone up, and students have taken a look at HBCUs, what that means for sort of their own cultural identity and how they want to contribute to the world, and are choosing us in a much different way than they had been even 5-10 years ago.
Great. I'm going to go to Jennifer Brinkerhoff. She doesn't really have a question, but you might want to, if you want to just talk a little bit about your book.
Yes, I'm not sure. Can you hear me?
Yes.
You can.
Awesome. Yes. Thank you so much. So we would be very pleased to engage with folks from HBCUs around a new book that I had the privilege of working on with Aaron Williams and Taylor Jack. Aaron Williams is retired USAID and was a sector leader in international affairs in the nonprofit sector, government, and the private sector. And this was his legacy upon retirement, was to engage his peers, his colleagues, all of the giants who went before, to be able to collect advice and guideposts to the next generation of young Black leaders who are interested in international affairs. So we would love to share that material with you, and with support from the Hewlett Foundation, we are able to engage in some related events and provide copies of the book. So I can put my email address in the chat, but we're very much interested in the intergenerational dialogue that this book represents, because we really believe that this is what the next generation needs, is to learn from those of you who went before and have succeeded, and know better than anybody else what the challenges are and how best to navigate them. Thank you so much for the opportunity to share this important work, and I hope that we can partner together. Thank you.
Hey, Jen, let me just say quickly, I saw this question earlier. I've already taped it. I mean, I've copied it and emailed it to myself before you talk. So I do want to talk to you, one. And then there is our chair of political science, economic development, and international affairs, Dr. Donna Patterson, will be a great point of contact for you. So please put your email in the chat. I'll send you a note.
Thank you. And we can make sure that we send it. And Jennifer, you're at George Washington University, correct?
Yes, I am at GW. Yeah.
Great. And Pearl Robinson of Tufts has put in the chat, what's the title of the book? And the title of the book is The Young Black Leader's Guide to a Successful Career in International Affairs. It's above, it's in the Q&A, so you can get the link there. All right, so if others have questions, please raise your hand. I'm going to call upon President Verrey to ask a question. I'm putting him on the spot. But
Thank you for putting me on the spot. I guess the question that I would ask is also about the Americans, the nation's talent need from a national security perspective, also from an economic perspective. The talent that is needed to actually drive the American economy, drive Americans in a leadership position. And as the United States is becoming essentially majority minority, can the United States, how important is it that we develop the talent that is in our underrepresented populations in order to sustain America's leadership?
Yeah, well, Mr. President, I'm sure you know the answer to that question. It's critical. It's absolutely critical. And like I said, as you all know, we find ourselves looking at work in the future of work in a much different way I imagine any of us thought possible at this pace that we're moving. So it's effectively is to say that we are training students for jobs that have not yet been invented. So how we do that relative to their ability to analyze critically, write in a way that not only is clear, but is compelling with respect to how they tell stories, be creative in the ways in which they want to engage in the world, and how they think about themselves as citizens, I couldn't be more important. And I'd say, particularly in the African-American community and other communities of color, it's critical relative to the future of those communities. As I said, and you know this, the contributions of HBCUs just as one example, from an economic development standpoint, are substantive, but they represent a proxy for a much broader contribution from communities of color throughout this country. And you know, we've seen some symbols just recently. If you look at the president's cabinet, most diverse cabinet in the history of the United States, obviously I know many of you probably saw the hearings for soon to be Supreme Court Justice Ketanji Brown Jackson. You saw the good and bad of that, and what that might portend for our own civility in this country. So I get up every day thinking about the fact that I have a lot of students whose life circumstances are changing because of Delaware State. And in so doing, at least in part, in so doing, they have to be a part of the solution for really salvaging our democracy. So that is not just your new engineer or your new political scientist or your new accountant or banker. You have to be really a part of this process if we're going to get it right. So I appreciate the question. And I know you all know just how important that is, not only in the American context, but around the world.
Thank you. I'm just going to take another question for from Xavier University of Louisiana. We just heard from the president, but now from Pamela Waldron Moore, who's on the Political Science and International Relations faculty. I've taken my role of internationalizing our students very seriously. Many of my department's graduates have gone on to be foreign service officers thanks to the Rangel and Pickering fellowships made available to them. Today, many have lost interest in international service, seeing their service in diplomacy more as tokens than as valued for their intellectual capital. Fewer are interested in pursuing career diplomacy. What encouragement can you give international faculty who recognize the importance of Black students representing the Black story?
Well, you know, first of all, it's a great question. And that international development is not the only space where folks check a box on the number of students of color they might have in a program. And that's problematic for all the reasons you outlined. Some of the things we're doing, again, with our Career Pathways programming, is suggesting that the institutions that we're working with think of doing business with us in cohorts. So it's not just the one person that got the one opportunity and then nothing else happens, but you build capacity for 4 or 5, 8 or 10 students to get this a similarly situated opportunity where they can lean on each other, but also see faces that look like them and can be encouraging in that way. That's one. Second, is the institutions themselves have to really look at their own pipelines for senior leadership, which is really challenging. So it's not just that you can find the young Black or brown talent, the new young Black or brown talent out there, but does your organization look like the community you serve up and down that organization? And that's a little bit of, it's been my struggle in trying to provide some advice and counsel to institutional leaders who are really serious about this business, because it does take some bold leadership, looking in places you had not looked before, opening doors you might not have otherwise seen, and then recognizing that if you do that, your pipeline will grow as a result, because those students will see the institution as serious about the issue. So I would say don't give up. I would say press harder.
Thank you. So the next question from Dr. Todd Berry, professor at Hudson County Community College. How far north geographically do HBCUs go? And he hails from Connecticut.
I'm only laughing because I don't think I've ever gotten that question before. But I'm pretty north, actually. Most of the HBCUs are in the southeast, not all of them, but most of them. The northernmost, I guess, would be Cheney University, the first one. There are two in Pennsylvania, Cheney University and Lincoln. Lincoln's basically the second, though they will fight over that that reputation. But they are about 20 minutes from each other, and then I am about an hour and 10 from them. So the northernmost are really Cheney and Lincoln.
Thank you. Next, any other questions? I want to just say that next week we are hosting a in-person workshop in New York for college and university professors on the 28th and 29th of April. And we have several professors from HBCUs, which we're really excited about. But if you want to send any more our way, we would welcome it. The other thing that we do every year is we host a conference on diversity and international affairs. So it's a collaboration that CFR does with the Global Access Pipeline and International Career Advancement Program. And the dates of that are May 20, let's see, I think 24th and 25th. And we have students come for that, and it's a great professional development. So hopefully, if those of you on the call want your students to come, sorry, May 25th and 26th, I was off by a day. If you, any of you want your students to come, we would love to have them. That takes place in DC. Okay, so I'm just looking for any other questions. The other thing I would love for you to talk a little bit, you mentioned your emphasis now on partnerships with government and getting more support from the federal government. But your background, you also had a corporate background. Mm-hmm. So how have you in your position, how have HBCUs traditionally leveraged corporate and industry partnerships to build awareness and foster engagement? And what are you specifically doing given your background in that space, the 13 years that you spent?
That's actually, I shouldn't say it this way, but that has not been as challenging. I think the corporate community recently in particular, they've showed up in a pretty thoughtful way on balance. And I don't just mean at Delaware State, but I think at institutions across the country. The one caveat to that is that fourth priority I mentioned, which is sometimes our smaller HBCUs are left out of that equation because folks don't know the whole story, that it is there are 101 of them, that they cut across any number of disciplines, that they're all doing really high quality work. So being able to, as I said, build the profile HBCUs is important. With respect to what we've been able to do, we've had some significant, really record-breaking fundraising over the last 2 years with the corporate community. And the idea has cut across a number of opportunities for us. One is that catalytic engine I just mentioned. I mean, without JPMorgan Chase or Bank of America, we wouldn't have 40 other corporate partners who really want to be doing business with us in a much different way than they have in the past. And then the emerging opportunities, there's an organization called Propel out of Atlanta. If you don't know that one, you should. Is largely funded by the Southern Company and Apple. And it's all a part of their racial equity and inclusion efforts. And the idea is that you would create a virtual HBCU space for all HBCUs to have their students engage across a number of core disciplines. For us, we're spending a lot of time being a beacon school for agricultural technology. For others, it's the arts, et cetera, et cetera. And it's a way for the HBCU students to connect with each other across these emerging disciplines and older disciplines, and also for the companies to connect with these students as well and give them some practical experience relative to what's happening in a new workspace, what the expectation is in those new workspaces, what's coming down the pike that many of us hadn't seen before. So it is a unique opportunity because more businesses are coming into that space. They're finding out about HBCUs in a much different way. And that is creating obviously new opportunities for the students themselves, but as I said, equally important for the companies who are serious about the business of diversity, equity, and inclusion.
Fantastic. I'll just note Ambassador Perry has a comment in the Q&A box about and how the, as a co-drafter of the Wrangell program and enabling students to enter the Pickering program, there are opportunities now at the State Department that offer paid internships. So that's important to mention. So now I'm going to go to Harold Schmitz, senior scholar at the University of California, Davis, who has raised his hand.
Hi, yeah, it's Harold Schmitz. And thanks for this. So I'm actually serving on a blue ribbon panel at the National Academy of Sciences. And so we're looking at from a land grants perspective, you know, across 1862, 1890, and 1990s, thinking of specifically about food and agriculture research and how to enhance, you know, collaboration between the whole land grant enterprise as opposed to, you know, the traditional sort of 1862s. And so I'd really appreciate hearing your views on, you know, how would you see, you know, the land grant enterprise from your perspective, you know, operating at a much higher and more collaborative, you know, sort of speed and nature than it currently is.
You know, it's an interesting question, Howard. I'm glad you asked it. And a couple of observations. One, I serve on the Council of 1890s. And for the room, there are about 18 HBCUs that are 1890 land grant institutions. And the idea is that we would spend and build deeper relationships with some of our 1860 PWI counterparts, but also among each other. I think the one thing that we as HBCUs generally in 1890s in particular can do a bit more clearly is find those unique opportunities in our own space and build capacity together. I did mention Cheney and Lincoln, and I saw that one of our colleagues corrected me. There absolutely are two great HBCUs in Ohio and Central and Wilberforce as well. But what we do it from time to time, but what we don't do often enough is find a way to really build collaborative comprehensive research projects across our spaces and proposals and then present them as unique opportunities. We usually, this isn't unfortunate, but it is a fact, go to the larger PWIs who you know, have bigger capacity, more staff, more opportunity. And then when we do that, we become a sub to that project, which nothing wrong with being a sub, but if you're always a sub, then you're not going to get the kind of capacity to really build your own research protocol and framework. So we're trying to do a better job of that as we move forward. And then, as I said, because of the profile that we have received here recently, many more opportunities are coming our way. And what I mean by that is many more conversations. We'll see if those conversations turn in to substantive research dollars and the like, but we are having many more conversations with the right people around how we are able, how we can build support and capacity for our own research interests.
Great, thank you. Any other questions? We're coming to the end of our time, so. There are a lot of sort of compliments in the Q&A box saying that this has been very inspiring discussion. Thank you for your important work. So just noting that. In our final minutes, Tony, it would be great if you could talk about, you know, sort of, you know, what are, you mentioned the four areas that you're going to focus on with President mm-hmm. Biden's but what do you want, what would you say to all of us to be doing in our communities to help with these efforts?
Well, let's put HBCUs aside for a second. You know, the story of the country is a story of struggle, right? And that's certainly true in the African-American context, but I think that's true overall. And our ability to be a more thoughtful, civil society that really lifts all boats is the final, in my view, is the final frontier for the country. And I think an opportunity for the world if we get it right. So, you know, oftentimes I say it's a little less, difficult for you to find diverse talent pipelines if your proximity is one that has diverse pipelines in it, which is to say, who do you go to church to with? Who do you eat dinner with? Who do your friends talk to? Those are the opportunities that I've had in my life kind of in the reverse, right? That has helped me, help open doors for me, help me get connected in the right ways, help me open doors for other people. But if we are living largely separate, distinct, homogenous lives based on our race, ethnicity, or gender, it's going to be a much difficult and really more, you'd have to have a much more concerted effort to break the barriers that are largely artificial in our context. They really are largely artificial when you think about them. They have been cemented by sort of these systemic concerns, but they are largely artificial. And this, having an opportunity like this in front of the council, I think is actually pretty important part of the process, because you're going to expose yourself in a way that you might not have thought of. Quite frankly, it's one of the reasons I said yes to doing this, because I'm exposing myself to something I might not have crossed my mind in my business. Now I know why important it is. So I would just have you think about proximity in your own lives, as I certainly do, and where you see the opportunity to make a real difference, do it and do it boldly.
Wonderful. Thank you. And this has been really terrific opportunity for us too, to have this exchange with you. Thank you for your leadership. If nobody else has a question, we will close a couple minutes early because I know that everybody is busy, and we really appreciate you taking the time from your busy schedule to do this. So thank you for that. And thanks to everybody for their comments. We can circulate links after this to the transcript of video, as well as some of the resources that have been mentioned. Again, I'm just going to say, if you have a professor that you want to send next week to our College and University Educators Workshop, reach out to me. and of course, we will be sending out information about our diversity conference because this is extremely important to us. We also have paid internships at CFR, which is extremely helpful and important as we look to diversify. So thank you again, Dr. Allen. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
And to all of you, please continue to follow us at CFR Academic on Twitter. Visit cfr.org, foreignaffairs.com, and thinkglobalhealth.org. I know this is a busy time for all of you with finals, graduation, and everything else. So good luck with the rest of the semester, and we look forward to your continued participation.